Tiny Broadwick, first lady of parachuting. What a gal. Over 1,100 jumps in less than a decade. She was born before the Wright brothers' flight at Kitty Hawk and lived to see the landing on the moon. She was married at 12, had a baby short time thereafter, and then was abandoned. She is an iconic skydiver. As I cover this talk on Tiny, you're going to see more and more. She's not the little girl that's depicted in the doll girl outfit. She was a randy little thing, illiterate most of her life, but the sweetest thing anybody that ever met her would say she was the sweetest thing in the world. She likes a little bit of bourbon in her coffee also.
Is Tiny Broadwick when she was known as the doll girl of aviation. One of these ladies is Tiny Broadwick as she appears today. What is your name, please?
My name is Tiny Broadwick.
My name is Tiny Broadwick.
My name is Tiny Broadwick.
Only one of these ladies is the real Tiny Broadwick. The other two are imposters and will try to fool this panel. Tom Poston, Peggy Cass, Orson Bean, and Kitty Carlisle. On To Tell the Truth with your host, Bud Collier.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and welcome once again to Tell the Truth.
I'm going to talk for a minute about what got me started on this Tiny Broadwick project and my yearly talks on Tiny. It was this picture right here. A gentleman by the name of Bill Roby had posted some pictures on Facebook of Tiny, and then I followed up with several that I had, this being one of them. He came back with a reply and said, "That's a nice recreation picture that you found. Where'd you find it?" And I said, "That's not a recreation. That is Tiny." He came back saying, "That is not Tiny. I know Tiny better than I know my own mother. And you're trying to tell me that's not Tiny? It's like telling me I don't know my mom." I said, "You want to bet? Case of beer?" His reply was, "Absolutely." So then I replied back with three references, one of them being Dan Pointer, second one being Getty Museum, Getty Images, and a third one being a Russian website. Well, he came back with poo-pooing the Russian website, not liking Dan Pointer's thing too much, and then telling me about how great he was. And I was like, "I don't care about how great you are. Prove to me that this is not Tiny." Well, he did. He came back with newspaper articles of this woman, Ethel's death. She was turned out being Ethel Broadwick Knutson. was Charles Broadwick's second or third wife, but it was the second wife to be killed in a skydiving accident or a parachuting accident. So he then forwarded me this next photo, which is Ethel's gravestone. Well, even though it's defaced, you can see on the jawline that it is probably her. So I relented, asked him what the name of the local liquor store that he dealt with, and I was going to give him my card number and let him go buy himself a case of beer. Well, he said, "No, keep the case of beer, take it to Felicity when you do your talk, and just give it away on my from me." And I said, "Oh, okay, good." So I went to Felicity. I did my talk there, the first one. And it was just kind of ad lib, but it was a good way to give away two cases of beer because I matched his case of beer. And it worked out real good. I was real happy with it, and that's what got me started on the Tiny Broadwick project. Tiny was born dirt poor on a farm in Granville, North Carolina, April 8, 1893. Her parents were George and Emma Ross Thompson. She was the last of seven daughters. She weighed only 3 pounds and was given the nickname Tiny due to her small size. Some state that she only reached 4'1 and weighed about 80 pounds as an adult. I think that's a little small. She was maybe taller than that. But her early life was rough. It was one of hardship. Her parents raised pigs and chickens, and she worked the tobacco fields, pulling worms, picking worms off of tobacco. Well, the parents' farm failed. They had to give up the farm, and so they took work at the Harriet Cotton Mill in nearby Henderson, North Carolina. And at the same time, Tiny married a guy by the name of William Aussie Jacobs when she was only 12. and became pregnant a short time thereafter. She ended up being a straw widow. He vanished. He took off and left her, abandoned her and the daughter, Verla. And so Tiny, to make ends meet, had to take a job working 12, 14-hour shifts, earning only 40 cents a day. She'd walk home to nurse her baby and then go back several times a day to nurse her child and then go back to work. But her life of boredom was soon going to end. Tiny soon convinced a neighbor to take her to Raleigh. The Johnny Jones Exposition Show was going on there, and they featured an act called The Broadwicks and the Famous French Aeronauts, which featured a stunt performer named Charles Broadwick, another stage name. Actually, his name was John Murray. He dropped from a hot air balloon and descended using a parachute. Tiny stuck around and watched and was convinced that she could do a better job than him. She quoted, "When I seen this balloon go up, I knew that's all I wanted to do. I hung around until they came back to the lot where the balloon had left from, and I told them I wanted to join them. I was hellbound and determined to get into the act."
Number two, how did you get started doing this, may I ask?
I guess it's because I was a tomboy, wanted to do something different.
Well, Broadwick knew a good thing when he saw it, and her small size making her an easy, light and easy descent. Tiny convinced Broadwick to join her crew, his aerial performance. Charles Broadwick needed a little convincing. I don't think so, but it's what's reported. But he knew a good thing when he saw it. He promised to send money back to Tiny's daughter. And in order to travel with Tiny, he had to adopt her. So therefore, the name Tiny Broadwick was born. Georgia Ann Thompson was her name and continued to be her name until the end of her life. But she was Tiny Broadwick under the balloons, she was Tiny Broadwick under canopy, and she was Tiny Broadwick under the wing of an airplane. But in her real life, she was Georgia Ann Thompson. So like I said, she convinced Broadwick to let her join the aerial performers. They made a jump before they left Raleigh.
Mrs. Broadwick, how long ago was it that you made your first parachute jump?
I made my first parachute drop from a hot air balloon in 1908.
Well, now, they did have airplanes at that time. Why did you jump from a balloon?
Well, the airplanes wasn't very far advanced at that time, and no one thought about anyone ever jumping from an airplane at that time.
Well, she had to convince her mom, and he had to convince her mom, and she had the baby to think about. So Charles adopted her because it wasn't considered proper to travel with for a man to travel with a young lady, or a young lady to travel with a man back then that wasn't related to her. So he adopted her, and she became became Tiny Broadwick. And she continued to do the shows. She would hang from a trapeze underneath a balloon. And we're not talking about a hot air balloon that was made recently, the type that are propane fueled. We're talking about one that they dug a pit, they started a kerosene fire, and they draped this canvas bag over the hole. It would inflate with coal smoke, and she was hooked underneath or hanging underneath from a trapeze, sometimes with three parachutes. So she would do one drop, cut away that chute, continue dropping to the next chute, and then the next one, sometimes three of them. Red, white, and blue was quite often the three canopies that she used.
In number two, did you use three different parachutes on the way down?
Yes.
Who folded your parachutes?
I did.
So, Miss Tiny Broadwick, the most daring aviatrix parachutist, was born. She traveled, like I said, she traveled all over the country with the Johnny Jones Carnival, and she was billed as a doll girl. She absolutely hated it. Billed as a doll girl because of her small size, she performed in ruffled bloomers, a silk dress, and pink bows in her hair. An outfit the rough and tumble Tiny hated. Tiny made her first jump before she left Raleigh, and she landed right in the middle of a blackberry bush. It's a funny story. If you read the book Elizabeth Roberson wrote on Tiny Broadwick, it goes into more detail on the blackberry bush story, but it's very funny. Like I said, there's copies of Tiny's biography up here signed by Elizabeth Roberson. The proceeds go to the Skydiving Museum and Hall of Fame. So like I said, Tiny became an instant headliner. And she started performing jumps under multiple parachutes, like I said, sometimes with flares and torches. And she had quite a few mishaps. Parachutes would catch on fire. The balloons would come undone. She landed on top of a train. She got hung up in a windmill. She landed in power lines. I mean, many rough landings. She broke several bones. She dislocated her shoulder on several occasions, but she never lost the enthusiasm for jumping. Now, Broadwick had promised to send money back to support Vera. That was part of the deal. But Broadwick, he was a carny. Or that, at worst, at best, he was a bad financial manager. But so quite often, instead of the $200 that was promised to Tiny to be sent back to her mother to take care of Vera, quite often she just got a Coke and a candy bar, sometimes just pocket change. Like I said, Broadwick was not a good financial manager. During one of Tiny's drops at the, believe it was the 1911, not sure, Los Angeles Air Show, she had landed off the airport and was picked up by a pilot by the name of Glenn Martin. Now, quite a few of the best in aviation would show up at these early aviation meets. This is less than 10 years after the Wright Brothers flights, and we're already having multiple pilots flying in. I mean, the cream of the crop were showing up at these aviation meets. Well, Tiny landed off the airport or off the grounds and was picked up by Glenn Martin and flown back. And he asked her, "Would you like to join, or would you like to drop from my airplane?" And she said, "Oh, I'd love to." Well, anyway, she met Orville Wright while she was there, and he told her, "I'm glad you're interested in aviation." And her reply was, "I'm mainly interested in parachutes." Well, like I said, at that Los Angeles air meet, she met manufacturer Glenn Martin, and he picked her up in the airplanes after she landed off airport. And that was a turning point in her life. He proposed the drop from one of her airplanes, and jumping at the chance, she agreed without hesitation. On July 21st, 1913, Tiny Broadwick, from a trapeze-type swing, suspended under the right wing of Martin's aircraft, just behind the wing.
After you had done your hot air balloon jump, then you worked into airplanes later on, didn't you?
Yes, we worked into airplanes. We went into that in 1913, and I worked with Glenn L. Martin, and I worked out at Griffiths Park in Los Angeles, and that was the start of the parachute work from airplanes.
The parachute was developed by Charles Broadwick, and it was on a shelf right above her, right by the wing. She had a lever underneath the trapeze that would release the seat from underneath her, and the parachute was hooked by a static line, which opened automatically, and she parachuted safely to Earth. So she landed in Griffith Park, and she therefore became the first woman to parachute from an airplane. Martin, Broadwick, and Tiny started working together. Tiny would drop from his trapeze on his airplane quite a few times. I don't have the exact number, but it was a lot. And she would do demonstration jumps. She would do giveaways. One of the gift giveaways they did over Los Angeles was Martin would fly his airplane over the city, and they would drop little parachutes with coupons for free this or free that. Well, the day she did that, there was two reporters, Grace Wilcox and Bonnie Glessner. Now, Bonnie Glessner, she said, "I faced and I turned around, I saw the eyes of a child. She was clambering over the side of the airplane as though it was stationary. Once over, she clung tenaciously, her eyes fixed on Martin, who was just looking down at the side of his airplane. The signal came, and while I watched below, just the slight movement of the hand, the girl was gone. I understand her lips formed a goodbye when I sensed rather than heard. Smiling at me, she stepped off into space, not even a tremor of the machine showing she was gone. As I watched with thickly beating heart, this nervy little girl stepped calmly over the edge of the aeroplane, 1,000 feet into the air, and the brave little smile plunged earthward." That same year, Tiny parachuted from a hydroplane, the first to parachute into water on purpose.
Now, we're standing right next to a parachute, which we have draped over a banister here. Which parachute is this? Is this one that you used in your early days of jumping?
Yes, this is one that I used mostly in my exhibition work as I traveled around from airplanes.
Uh-huh.
And this is the one I should give to the state of North Carolina.
I believe this is going to the Department of Archives and History here.
Yes.
Now, what kind of a rig did you use to carry this on your back? I guess it was on your back, wasn't it?
Yes. We use something like a Boy Scout's knapsack on the back, and I think I have a coat that I could show you.
Girl, if you'll hand me that thing, I believe we'll look at that too. That's this is the jacket you used to
yes,
use.
Yes, this is the jacket, and this is where I put my parachute in, and I would put this little coat on, and I have a little seat here. That when I come down, I would tie that around and sit on this little seat. And I never was hanging in space. I just had a little seat to sit on.
And you had a ripcord with this, I guess.
Yes, this is the ripcord that I had over my shoulder. We tied it on the other side. And then when I would pull that, my parachute would come out of there, and I always come down safely.
Well, apparently you did.
She also is doing a demonstration for the governor of Illinois, Edward Dunn, when she landed in Lake Michigan to present him with a wreath. We have this picture right here. In 1914, this was very important. Tiny and Martin and Broadwick demonstrated the parachute to the U.S. Army. Her reputation as a parachutist and Broadwick's coat pack led the military into contact with her. They had a formal demonstration because many pilots were being killed during the war. No way to escape from an airplane. Tiny was going to demonstrate how to parachute from a military airplane. She made 4 jumps, San Diego's North Island. Then 4th jump, very important jump for all of us. On her 4th jump, her parachute line became tangled in the aircraft's tail assembly. And the slipstream prevented her from getting back into the plane. Now, I'm not really sure how this exactly happened. I mean, we all know about static lines. It's kind of confusing to me. But anyway, she was able to reach up and cut the static line to a short length, and she went into free fall, therefore becoming the first person, man or woman, to do a planned free fall descent. It was the first deployment using a ripcord. She had proven that a pilot could return to the ground safely by bailing out of an airplane. As a result, also, Tiny became the first person to ever free fall from an airplane. Brigadier General Jim P. Scriven, who's a chief signal officer, had recommended the purchase of a number of parachutes, this being prior to World War I.
Did you have any luck in presenting this to the government, or did you have any contact with the government on this?
Well, yes, we had luck. We sold them a couple of parachutes in San Diego. Dad Broderick, got them very interested, and they brought a couple, and then they just stopped until Second World War, I'm not so sure about that, is when they picked up again to become more interested in parachutes.
But in other words, the earlier pilots in the American Air Force, I guess that's what it was at that time, didn't have any parachutes at all.
No, they didn't have any.
Fires were common in airplanes, and many pilots carried pistols with them to commit suicide rather than burning, or just bailed out without a canopy at all and hammered in. So Tiny proved that it could be done, and could be done safely. She continued to jump with Martin. She jumped at the 1915 and the 1916 World Fair. 1915-1916 World Fair. She retired, or quit jumping, stopped jumping for 4 years. She married Harold Brown, ended in divorce, and so did her marriage to Andrew Olson. Not recall which one it was, but one of them was the founder of Greyhound Bus Lines. I believe it was Harold Brown. She also severed her relationship with Charles Broadwick during that time. She continued to go by the name of Georgia Brown, like I said, until her death. She considered Broadwick to be her stage name. She did return to jumping again in 1920 for 2 years, but the novelty had worn off, and her ankles were beginning to bother her, and she was reluctant to give up parachuting because she said, "Honey, I breathe so much better up there. It is so peaceful being that near to God. Tiny was a very religious person. So she retired permanently, made her last jump in San Diego in 1922. Like I said, 1,100 jumps. She was 29 years old. Tiny's retirement didn't come easy. She said, "It was terrible hard for me to settle down." She's a real skydiver here. "It was terrible hard for me to settle down. I had much pep and energy. I was lonesome for my work and occasionally made a few jumps." But she remained a powerful influence in aviation. I don't recall the name right now, but she became a housekeeper and cared for the elderly during a period between 1922 and, I don't know, around 1930s, 1940s. She was doing house cleaning for these people, and they figured out who she was and her powerful influence in aviation. So she started receiving honors. They put her out there, and she became, well, most decorated parachutist there is, I would say. I mean, she received many honors. The U.S. government's Pioneer Aviation Award, the John Glenn Medal. She was the only woman in the 80-member early birds of aviation. Now, let me tell you something about the early birds. The early birds were the original aviators. Tiny, it took a little bit of work to get her in there because she didn't fly an airplane. But she did take off in a craft. She did exit that craft and land under a balloon or a parachute. And quite often, she had to land the balloon itself. You know, like I said, it was dangerous, and they honored her, and she became one of the early members of the early birds.
Yes, I'm recognized by the early birds. That is the real flyers in the early days, and I'm recognized by the OX5, and that's a big organization that takes over when the early birds all passed away. They carry on.
Oh, I see. Well, you have a citation, I believe, from the early birds, haven't you?
Yes, I have an award from the early birds, and I'm very proud of it.
Well, let's look at it. I'd like to see it because I think you should be proud of it.
Verla, would you bring that in for me, please?
I believe this is your daughter.
Yes, this is my daughter, Verla.
And this is your citation from the early birds, is that correct?
That's
good.
Right.
And I don't suppose many of those, thank you very much, Verla. I don't suppose many of those have gone to women, have they?
No, we don't have too many women now for the early birds. I think there's very few of them left.
And she got her gold wings from the Adventurers Club in L.A., and she was made an honorary member of the 82nd Airborne at Fort Bragg. She was told, with that honor, she could jump anytime she chose. How would you like to do that? Then May 5th, 1964, Tiny Broadwick dinner. Tiny donated her parachute to the National Air Museum, and they said, measured in feet and inches, her nickname Tiny is obviously appropriate. Measured by her courage and by her accomplishments, she stands tall among many of her colleagues, the pioneers of flight. Like I said, the Adventurers Club of Los Angeles held Tiny Broadwick night on November 16, 1972. Norm Heaton, we all know Norm, might be in the crowd out there. Hold your hand up, Norm. Of the Norm Heaton, USPA, he presented her with her gold wings for 1,000th jump. Like I said, Tiny was honored by the Golden Knights. She was an honorary member of the Golden Knights, the highest award the Golden Knights give to a civilian. She spent her last years in California. She passed away on August 25, 1978, at the age of 85. She was laid to rest by members of the U.S. Army Golden Knights. Hey, if you look at this picture right here, this is a picture of her with the Golden Knights, four of them. This is the four-way team. If you look on the far right, there's Ron Walker. Next to him is Dennis Sadler. Ron Walker put me out the first time on my first dive-out exit, and Dennis Sadler took my job at Paris when I left. I didn't know either one of them were Golden Knights, and when I saw this picture, I was stunned. Well, it was the eight-way team that laid her to rest. She, like I said, she died on August 28, 1978. Got her obituary. A historical marker in her honor was erected in 2004 in North Carolina. Tiny continued to visit drop zones late into her years. In fact, here's some pictures. Here she is at Elsinore. I don't recognize any of the jumpers there. Some of you may. Well, Then we got Bill Booth. Recognize that guy? That picture there is actually from Dan Pointer's PowerPoint presentation. And then everybody recognizes this honey right here, huh? Stand up, T. Wave. All right, in this group over here, there's Jan Works. She's the only one not looking at the camera. And then the currently reigning First Lady of Parachuting, First Lady of Skydiving, Mariel Simbro. Like I said, Tiny Broadwick made over 1,100 jumps. She was injured quite often. There's quite a few articles that I've been able to find. Here's one about her when she was injured. Here's another one. And then, let's leave this one up for a minute. Let's talk about this. Here is a little girl, 12 years old, working on a tobacco farm in North Carolina. She has the gumption to go talk to a circus performer and ask if she can jump from this bag of smoking coal smoke and descend under it. She does it, becomes a celebrity for about 10, 15 years, jumping all over the place. She was born before the Wright brothers flew. She lived long enough to see the moonwalk. What a gal, a real contributor to our sport. Here's Tiny's rig. This is the Broadwick coat pack. One of the Golden Knights asked her, I don't know if it was Golden Knights or when she was at Fort Bragg, but a military person asked her if she had a reserve. And she said, oh, yes, it's in my garage at home in case this one tears.
Well, let's find out who's right and who's wrong as we learn now which one of these ladies actually was known as the doll girl of aviation. Will the real Tiny Broadwick please stand up?
It's been delightful talking to the Tiny Broadwick. Thank you very much for talking with us.
Well, it's been a pleasure to visit and try to tell you a little something of my past experience in parachutes, and I hope it'll prove worthy to you.
I'm sure it will. Thank you so much.
Thanks, my pleasure.
What a gal. Thank you all for coming. Like I said, my name is Bob Lewis. Hopefully this thing worked out well. There's people out here that met Tiny. It'd really be nice if you could come up and continue this talk. I'm obviously not going to be able to hear it, but maybe somebody will record it and I get to hear it. Because I know, Jan has met him. Jan has met her and quite a few other jumpers. So thank you again for attending. Hope you all have an enjoyable celebration tomorrow. And I should be back on my feet and mean as ever in a month or so. So thank you again for coming.